So I really want to also stress that not all carbs are created equal, that eating these starchy vegetables does not mean that you're eating a lot of sugar, as sometimes you may hear online and particularly some influencers would suggest. But actually, this causes a slow release of sugar across your entire small intestine, and then most of it reaches your colon and is actually feeding your bugs. And one thing that's interesting about starch, it's the most abundant biomolecule on Earth after cellulose. And it's the major carbohydrate reserve in plant tumors and seed endosperms. So this is something that's very common and something that we've highly evolved to consume. It's really what our GI tracts over the last 10,000 years have evolved, and our microbiome has evolved to consume. And so I really wanted to stress this. When you consume a can of Coke, which has 39 grams of sugar in it, you're just consuming 39 grams of this easily accessible glucose that will go directly into your bloodstream. When you have, for instance, an einkorn whole wheat spaghetti, it may seem like quite a bit of carbohydrates, right? 2 ounces of this pasta, might seem equivalent to a can of Coke. But by the way it's absorbed and stored, actually, this is very tightly packaged. And a lot of this, even with cooking the pasta, doesn't come unwound. And this is delayed in its absorption across the entire small intestine. And actually, 40 grams of this starch, 5 grams of it is fiber that it's your body is unable to absorb, actually. So this is 5 of that grams is actually being eaten by your microbiome. So if you are having a can of Coke, all of it gets absorbed into your bloodstream and none of it is available to the microbiome in your colon. Whereas if you were to eat an equivalent carbohydrate load of a whole wheat spaghetti, actually 5 grams of that is going to go into your colon to feed your microbiome. And most of this, because of its linkage, is going to be delayed in its absorption across the length of your small intestine and even into your colon. And this is the importance of eating whole foods and foods that have fiber in them. So I want to convey that carbohydrates are not your enemy. They're actually your friend, and they're your microbiome's friend. And most of the carbohydrates that exist, at the grocery store or at restaurants are in the form of simple carbohydrates. But if we focus on eating plant-based carbohydrates that are in their native plant matrix, actually, they come with a lot of fiber and that they're delayed in their glycemic load, and they're really going to not cause that spike in blood glucose. Thus, we should aim for complex carbohydrates that slow digestion and feed your microbiome. Sugar, on the other hand, does not feed your microbiome and will go directly into your bloodstream, leading to a glucose spike as well as an insulin spike. And in reference to the type 3 resistant starch, you may have seen this article that was widely circulated from the New York Times last year around this time, saying that pasta and rice may be healthier as leftovers. Here's why. And this may be true because of what I've told you. And I wanted to dig into the data from the original publication that this New York Times article is based off of, in particular because you'll notice that they display a large amount of white rice. And this is extremely misleading based on the data. So if you look, and what this was a review of measurements of resistant starch in foods in published works over the last 40 years. And so if you see here, pasta that's cooked and then pasta's cooked that then chilled actually reduces its resistant starch. So you're not getting any benefit here. However, if you were to move to a whole wheat pasta and you cook it here, it has 1.2. Actually, when you chill it, it increases to 3.4. So you really want to strive again for these whole wheat products and the non-processed carbohydrates. You can see this white rice here. When it's cooked, 1.4 of resistant starch. And then when it's cooked and chilled, 0.9. So we're not really seeing the benefit with white rice or with pasta. It's really the whole wheat. Potatoes, On the other hand, in any form, seem to be able to contain a large amount of resistant starch, and it's increased with cooking and chilling. So here you get 3.1 per gram, and or sorry, grams per 100 grams of food, and then it goes to 4.3 when cooked and chilled. So again, I want to stress eating whole grains and whole foods is important. The more purified the food, the less resistant starch it has in it, and the less benefit you'll get from cooking and chilling it. Other foods that have a large amount of resistant starch, you see bananas, unripe bananas in particular, have a good amount. Semolina, just cooked, actually has a large amount. And the legumes, which are powerhouses for your microbiome, have a really good amount within them, particularly lima beans, black beans, and chickpeas. And I wanted to take a step back and just talk about resistant starch. There's a lot of data emerging that resistant starch is a potent microbiome stimulator, and I just wanted to tell you a little bit more about resistant starch. So there are many types of resistant starch. I'll be discussing four of them today. And essentially, resistant starch is the type of carbohydrates that are tightly packed in a plant, usually in a plant seed or some sort of storage vessel like the root within a plant. And resistant starch type 1 is actually physically inaccessible due to the cell walls and protein matrix. So this would be like if you were to eat like a seed or a nut or raw corn off the cob. It's basically an unprocessed grain. And then what happens as we then grind flours to make them more processed or even cook it, what happens is that these carbohydrates then break out. And the degree to which we cook foods really determines how resistant the starch then becomes. And if you cook, for instance, rice, and you cook it for a long time, and then you actually let it cool down and put it in the fridge, what will happen is all of that carbohydrate that has then been liberated will actually recrystallize into a form called retrograded starch. And this is type 3 starch. So this example of this is cooked and cooled potatoes, rice, or pasta, which I'll talk about in a little bit. And then the fourth type of resistant starch is essentially a type of processed food. It's a processed fiber. It's a chemically modified starch that generates new molecular structures of starch, thereby increasing its resistance to amylase. And amylase is something that our pancreas secretes. So essentially, in theory, if one were to take, for instance, a pasta and cook it, and if your pancreas secretes a lot of amylase, a lot of that will be absorbed in the small intestine, and not all of it will reach the colon. Only the resistant starch portion will reach the colon. And then I just really wanted to reiterate the structure of this. So this is actually what all of these carbohydrates look like when they're packed in. You saw a single glucose molecule earlier was just that free-floating six structure. And if you were to connect it all together, it would create this ring. And you see in A, there's this reducing end. So actually the bacteria and independent of our amylases, our bodies can really only use the sugar that's at the distal end of this huge chain. And so this is really what happens when we eat this is that our bodies then take over our entire small intestine and actually our colon to digest it.